Chair, appointment of deputy chair. Do you have any nominations? Do you have a second? Thank you. Pass it to you, Madam Chair.
Okay, thank you, colleagues, for your continued support for me to be the chair of the authority. So, have you agreed to my shift, you said? Welcome again to Councillor Conception as vice chair. So, also, colleague, can we sort of make new introductions to new members? Can I welcome Councillor Charlie Preston from St. Helens. Welcome, Charlie. Some stage call, and I know we've got another new councillor who's maybe on the way or will be here soon. If we can have sort of 10 minutes with you, just to see if you can.
We wash it out to us.
Excellent. Okay. So, can any apologies for absence?
Councillor Nelson.
Okay, can that be noted, colleagues? So, minutes of the meeting of the authority held on the 21st of April 2017, that's item 4 on page 1. Is there any matters arising from that one? So can they be agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, so we go on to item 5, declarations of interest by members and officers. Do you have any? None received. So item 7 is questions from members of the public. Under rule 10, do you have any?
None.
None received. Be noted. So we go on to item 8, as motions proposed by members under rule 15 on page 9.
No.
None received. So that be noted. Okay, colleagues, so we go on to item 9, which is the scheme of delegation and procedural rules on page 11. And Paul, are you going to take us through that one?
Yes, thank you, Chair. This report deals with the adoption of the scheme of delegation, which is a requirement for the authorities to adopt at its AGM. Each year. The scheme describes the authority's decision-making process. It has been reviewed and a set of procedural rules have been reviewed and no amendments proposed. Members are therefore asked to adopt the scheme of delegation attached to Appendix 1 in accordance with the authority procedural rules.
To adopt the recommendations on the report. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
So we go on to item 10, questions on the discharge of functions on page 23, and Paul once again.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The authority is required to nominate one of its members from each of the 5 constituent district councils as the person who will answer questions put in the course of council proceedings by another council member about the discharge of the waste authority's functions. The authority nominates its members at a annual meeting each year, and the previous nominees are detailed on page 25, paragraph 1, 33.1. Members are therefore asked to nominate the members of each of the 5 constituent councils for the forward year.
Take one amendment for that, please. It's okay. St. Helens, can we change from Alan Cundiff to Charles Preston?
Yes.
That's the only change, isn't it, colleagues?
No.
Oh, and Kevin Kosky should be changed to Michael O'Brien. Sorry. Sorry, Mike. Can that be agreed? Okay. Can we note that report then, colleagues? Okay, so we go on to item 11, appointments of committees on page 27. Paula?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Members have the report which seeks the necessary appointments and approvals in relation to the authorities, committees and bodies for the 2017-18 municipal year. Page 39 details the table of nominations required. Can we have the nominations, please, Chair?
Do we have the nominations for the forwarded panel?
Right, Chair, could I just move the same members as last year, but as replacement for Alan Cundiff, Councillor Charlie Preston.
Happy agree, colleagues?
Agree.
onto the Appeals Committee.
Again, Chair, could I nominate the same members as last year and replacing Councillor Alan Cunliffe and Councillor Kevin Plusky with Councillor Diane Roscoe from Centre?
Of the Appeals.
Oh, sorry.
Just
one. Councillor Lovely.
Yeah, it's going to be Kevin Plusky, yeah. Okay, so we go on to the Audit and Governance Committee.
Again, the same members as last year, but replacing Councillor Plusky with Councillor Diane Roscoe and Councillor Carlson.
Can that be agreed?
Yeah.
Okay, so Investigating and Disciplinary Committee.
The same members as last year, and replacing Councillor Plusky with Councillor Diane Roscoe.
Can that be agreed? So we've gone to Mersey Waste Holdings Limited Board.
Could I move that the same members as last year, apart from Councillor Laura Robinson Collins, are to be replaced by Councillor Michael Brown?
And also Kevin Plusky to be replaced by Councillor Charles Preston.
Yes.
Can that be agreed? So we go to Piston Methane Limited Board.
Councillor Steve Williams and Councillor
Preston.
Preston.
Can that be agreed?
Agreed.
And North West Employees Organisation.
Councillor Norby.
Okay, welcome. UK. Welcome, you're alright, okay.
Sorry,
that's right, okay. So we go on to item 12, internal audit follow-up recommendations on page 41. Pete, are you going to take us through that?
Well, I guess, yeah, you're saying that. Our full members use the organisation. Just to remind you that the authority's internal audit is provided by St. Helens Council's internal audit team under a certified agreement. The brief report in front of you is part of the authority's governance arrangements, and it demonstrates to members whether or not the recommendations made by internal audit have been implemented or not, and the independent follow-up by internal audit of whether those recommendations have been implemented is key for members, in my opinion. The internal audit reviews are listed on page 43 and 44 of the summary report, and then appendix 1 to the report, set out on pages 45 and 48, show for each of the reviews where the recommendations were made, what they were, and confirm that they have been implemented properly. So members should be able to take assurance from the follow-up by internal audit that the governance of the authority remains sound on this occasion. Probably all I need to say on this one.
Alex, any questions or observations? Okay, another fairly good report from the auditors anyway. So can we note the consensus of the internal audit report? Can that be agreed? So we've got item 13, outturn report for 16-17 on page 49. Pete, take us through that one as well.
Yeah, thanks again, Chair. The outturn report provides members of the authority with an overview of the financial position and performance for the year ending 31st of March. And the report comments on capital expenditure, if we have any, the revenue outturn, and the authority's balances, as well as drawing attention to the prudential indicators. Starting with capital expenditure on page 51-52, members will be aware that the authority didn't have a capital programme last year because we were waiting for the outcome of the strategic review before we decided whether or not with you we would invest in further infrastructure. As a consequence, capital spending for the year was minimal, catching up on the previous year's commitments to the IT system Cognos and requiring no additional funding. And elsewhere in the capital section, we mentioned the invested composting equipment that's been sitting around for a while was eventually sold last year for £55,000, which is nice to have as a capital receipt. Moving on to revenue expenditure, which is covered in on page 52-55 and in quite a lot of detail in appendix 1. As I always offer to members, I'll either take you through that line by line here, or I can take members through it outside the meeting if they want more detail on it. There were some areas of the authority's activities where they were underspent, particularly in administration, strategy and resources. The underspend was offset by an overspend on the contract side of the budget, and the main part of that has arisen from anticipated levels of trade-based income not materialising from district councils. They've not pushed through as much trade waste as we expected. In particular, there is a large amount of income that was planned from one council that's not yet materialised. This is under discussion with the council, and agreements in outline have been made that we will actually receive that income, but I've not taken it into account in this because, being prudent, we might not. There is still some doubt about it. It's still under discussion. So hopefully we'll get a windfall of that slightly large amount, but we're not banking on it yet. We've been prudent on that one. Elsewhere in the revenue spent, we set aside an amount of money for our own service review following from the strategic review. And as we haven't had the outcome of the strategic review, we haven't spent that money on our own service review yet. So that's gone back into the balances, unfortunately, or fortunately for the balances. The interest that we were required to pay on our loan portfolio was lower than expected. So overall, the authorities had to contribute £136,000 less from the general fund to support revenue expenditure in the year, which is a decent result, I think. We talk about balances and reserves on page 56 of the report. Our members will see that after a contribution in the year of £6.2 million from reserves to support expenditure, the general fund stands at some £11.6 million. Now, this level of reserve would usually be considered higher than normal. However, members will be aware that the levy for 2017-18 has been kept at the same level as the previous 7 years. So there's already a requirement to utilise most of that general fund balance to support the levy to districts, mitigating its impact in the current year 2017-18. Over £8.8 million of that reserve is due to be used in 2017-18 to support the levy. And under current projections, the remainder will be used in 2018-19, regardless of a projected 11.5% increase in the levy in 2018-19. So that's where we are on the general fund. It looks high at the moment, but it's mostly committed. Capital reserve, which we have had in previous years, has now been exhausted. So any future capital programme plans will have to be funded from additional borrowing, which, while relatively low cost at present, will still carry with it additional revenue costs to the authority. So if we undertake a capital programme in future, that will be an additional revenue cost going forward. And then the very small balance on the capital receipts reserve reflects the sale of the investment compost equipment. This amount of £55,000 may only be used for capital purposes, as it was generated from the sale of the capital equipment. Finally, I mentioned the prudential indicators on page 57 and in appendix 2, on pages 73 to 74. These indicators demonstrate that the authority set affordable borrowing limits and confirm to members that the authority remained within those limits for the year. I think with that, I'll leave myself open to chair and questions.
Tony? Yeah, just on the large amounts of money coming from the council, can you elaborate a bit on that?
Sorry, Tony, I'm not sure. Are you talking about the large amounts of money coming from the general fund?
The council.
Sorry, one of the councils has been, in our view, using its trade waste vehicles to drop off waste into our facilities. There's an amount of between £250,000 and £350,000 outstanding, which the council initially said, we're not using your facilities for commercial waste, that's covered in the levy. We've been able to demonstrate in our view that they've been using it for their commercial waste, and that we've presented that council with the evidence. We've presented that council with the evidence, and that council's representatives have taken that away and said, yes, we believe that you're right, but those matters are still in discussion.
Just to clarify, essentially, if the council delivers waste to us,
and it's
a very big council, We sometimes get into these disputes. Were vehicles delivering household waste or trade waste? There's a dispute between ourselves and this very large council as to whether that was household or trade waste. We have the evidence. We've presented that evidence. There's an acceptance in principle by that council that we're right. We would say that, wouldn't we? But we are right. And that council will therefore pay for trade waste charges, as do other councils for their trade waste deliveries.
Quite clearly what we have is a vehicle identification system. Each council notifies us of the vehicles they are using to deliver domestic waste and to deliver commercial waste. We have a record of the vehicles that deliver commercial waste.
Any further questions? Okay, colleagues, can we agree with, thanks for that, Peter. Can we agree the recommendations on page 49? That be agreed. Thank you. So we go on to item 14. Resource recovery contract, and that's a progress update on page 75. And Ian, you're going to take us through that report?
I will do, thank you, Chair. The report provides members with a brief update overview of the resource recovery contract. By way of reminder, we said that we would not normally bring routine operational updates to the authority meeting, but we said that we would report on progress against the resource recovery contract whilst it remained in commissioning up until for operational service. Members will be aware of the delay to achieving full operational service, but I'm pleased to report some good recent progress in that regard. Roof repairs at the rail transfer loading station in Kirby have now been completed, and rail transport of waste from the facility up to the Wilton Energy from Waste facility recommenced on the 23rd of May. The contract itself is now taking the great majority of the authority's residual waste, and none is now going directly to landfill. The contract does, however, remain formally in commissioning at this point in time, but the contractor is focused and has given their commitment to achieving full service at the earliest opportunity. With regards to owner management at the Kirby facility that's been reported previously, SURES had commissioned and have now received their independently commissioned report and are acting on the findings of that report. They're currently updating the site's owner management procedures and the owner management plan, and are working with the statutory regulator, the Environment Agency, on developing that plan. I'm pleased to report that good progress has been made at the site, and whilst waste inputs have significantly increased at the site in the last month, there's also been a significant reduction in over complaints at the facility.
Any further comments or questions? Colleagues, we'll talk a bit of a time and get a bit control events like banging into the roof, to say the least. So at least that's all being done now. We're on track now to have the excellent facility that we wanted a few months ago. So hopefully we'll have a further report in the winter to see how it's gone. Okay. Tony?
Yes, Chair, I was just going to say, I mean, obviously it is good news that, that we're nearly there after all our the efforts, obviously. Sometimes outside of our control, but it's good to hear that we have made significant progress. Could I just ask in relation to the plans of the book, maybe it would be an opportunity for us to consider, maybe a visit by members up to Wilton and see exactly how it's running ourselves.
Yeah, thank you. Happy to organise that. We were planning to do that anyway. There is actually meant to be an official launch, and I believe the City Region Mayor may be getting an invitation to perform the opening with the Teesside City Region there, which might be quite interesting. We plan to do part of that. It will be the official launch, and that would be a visit. We'd also like to offer a visit for all members as well around. Obviously, some of the other facilities, especially the new members who may not have seen some of these facilities. And I'm also encouraging, as we earlier already do, community open days at facilities as well for the local community to see what's on their doorstep.
Okay, Tony. So we'll get a date in the diary, colleagues. Sometime it's September, this side of September. Maybe it's quite cold a bit. Okay, can we agree that report? I have no items for business, so thank you. Okay.
Should I mention the OEO? Just to thank the OEO for the community days they did the other.
very much for your attendance on this one, but talking